In terms of this idea of solidarity, the European Union becoming more of a unit, becoming more harmonious, do you think that's a fair representation from Mr. Juncker?
I think it's very important always to remember that this union is built up upon solidarity. And it's important now to see in times of Brexit that our chance to get ahead is to strengthen the solidarity, to bring more solidarity in, no matter whether we talk about the question of refugees or the social union. All of the fields of politics will be successful if we strengthen the principle of a solidaric union.
But in terms of what you just mentioned there, you mentioned refugees and migrants, you mentioned Brexit. In terms of those two instances, is it a fair representation from Juncker to say, yeah, you know what, the European Union is far stronger now, far more united now? I mean, if we look at Italy and Eastern European nations, it would indicate that there's far more disunity now than there has been 2-3 years ago.
Yeah, on the one hand, we have other problems than 2-3 years ago, and some of the problems even increase. But I think the Brexit decision had for the rest of the 27 member states also a good thing. In every end, there lies a beginning. Yeah, and this was a beginning point where everyone sees we cannot go on like we went on the last decades. So there were several thoughts and several fields of politics came up to develop new, stronger structures within the European Union, that we are also more flexible, more successful in the different fields of politics. And so I think on if you start from this point, he's right. We are now in a situation that in lots of fields of politics we see also more openness to discuss about things.
Stephen, in terms of, you know, the rest of Mr. Juncker's speech, he gave listed a number of initiatives he wants to see the European Union deliver on, particularly do foreign policy, monetary policy. Why has he decided to deliver such quite sweeping and quite significant integration projects now? And why the rhetoric about solidarity and being united? Well, what's his main motive there?
Well, in terms of solidarity, Peter's right. This is a phrase that runs right through the language, the lingua euro, you could say, of the European Union. They like to use it. I mean, I have a very strange way of considering the word solidarity. Sometimes it feels to me quite frightening. It's almost all-encompassing. You do as we say, and we'll say it's solidarity.
And did you think that of this speech?
Yeah, what I think about this speech was actually, for me, a different perspective to that of Peter. I think for Brexit has actually frightened the European political class, in the sense that you've got one group of people where the voters can make a decision and defeat the political class on the big issue of the day, and they're leaving. So here you now have a situation where they're saying, look, we've had lots of ideas, the single banking union, a single finance minister, a single minister for work, effectively, the issue of having a unified army, which they call the European Defence Force, then the president of the European Union. All of these ideas have been floating around for a while. So they're now seizing the opportunity, now that Britain's gone, to do this before anybody else can have a decision to leave, or perhaps try and leave. So solidify now and use the word solidarity to enforce the ideology behind it.
And you think it's a realistic outcome, the visions? Obviously he's talking a longer term project, you know, years in advance potentially, but you see that as the trajectory and it's going to actually be a reality?
I think the idea of a United States of Europe, some will call it a federal state, some will call it a sovereign principal state, has been there from the start. The question is, how long would it take other nations within there to really realise that if they're going to have this dream, then you've got to relinquish power in your own nation state to this place? And that's what's happening now. So there'll be some people who oppose it. You've got the Hungarians, the Poles. But the idea that you determine that some have to join the euro now, you're part of the club, therefore you've got to get rid of your currency, that will be more pressure on these nations to do it.
Rupert, what was your main reaction when listening to Mr. Juncker talk of, you know, the solidarity of Europe, but also the extent to which he sees European integration and the European project progressing? Did it surprise you? I mean,
no, my
as a relatively new MEP to the circuit, this might be an interesting.
Yeah, no, my main reaction was that if he'd made this speech 2 years ago, we'd had a much bigger majority voting in favour of Brexit in our referendum than we actually did. During the referendum campaign, and Stephen will know this, for years running up to it, Pro-EU politicians in Britain have denied that the European Union is about creating a United States of Europe. There'll never be a European army. They're never going to force Schengen on everybody. They're never going to force the euro on everybody. Those of us who have wanted Britain to be independent, on the other hand, have read the signs. We've known this has been on the cards for a long time. And now there it is, all in black and white. He's going to bring everybody into Schengen. Everyone's going to join the euro and so on. But the other thing that I spotted is he was talking about all these great plans and so on. But then towards the end, said that he was going to be calling a special summit of the EU27. To take place in 2019, just a few days after Britain leaves, and it was at that summit that he wants all these decisions to be taken.
One thing which I found really interesting in the speech, and perhaps Peter, I'll come to you on this, is this idea of, he said, we need to win the hearts and minds of the people of Europe.
Rewin.
The implication surely there is that he accepts that there is some degree of scepticism about the European project amongst the European people. Yes. I mean, just your thoughts on that.
Yes, he accepts this as realities in many member states, but sorry to say so, colleagues, there's lots of misunderstanding from your UK point of view to what the other think here. Here is no one frightened about the Brexit. We are sorry about the Brexit, but we know how to deal with this. And we will all lose after the Brexit, but you will lose more than we do. We are sorry about this, but we fight strongly, united, for more Europe. And the discussion came up today. It had nothing to do with now come up the truth after the Brexit decision. No, you are wrong in this. We took always, we always cared for the interests of all the 28 member states. If now one member state says we go out, who had several ideas of on some points where other member states had other ideas, it's clear that if this one goes out, the other ideas of the other member states get up stronger. And so more unity in the field of defense, more unity in the field of Schengen is the natural consequence of the Brexit. So let me say it like this, we are freer to do things the rest of the 27 member states want to do.
So you feel that we held you back from being able to do the things?
A union of 28 member states is always a union of compromises, and this is a good thing. And I'm really sorry that strong boys like the Britain boys leave the EU. So it was one kind of compromise in lots of fields, not to go perhaps as far as the other 27 would like to go. So if a country like UK goes, the other 27 are free to do whatever they like, and they do know.